previously on the Lords of Grantham podcast, we watched Downton Abbey Season 4, Episode 6. Now, there were some interesting plots that were started. So, Lady Edith found out she was pregnant, and Charles Blake came to the house. And this week, we are jumping into Season 5, and both of those subplots are still very much alive. There's a lot of other things going on, and there's some new characters, there's some characters we don't like, there's some characters we do like, and some relationship drama, as always. Classic talent. So, tune in, and enjoy. And we're back again.
Here we are, still doing Downton. We're going to be wrapping up our coverage soon, but you know, for now, we are in the cut of watching random Downton Abbey episodes at the moment.
Yeah, I mean, I think you can just look at your calendar. I mean, it's no surprise we're nearing the end of a month, and after doing this for a couple weeks, maybe in June things will finally change. We'll talk more about that next week.
It's been more than a couple weeks. This has been like a solid month now.
Yeah, well, I mean, we did it last year. We did a full month of Downton rewatches. So.
It's what comes easy to us.
And it's like people are interested. I feel like we're getting a lot of conversation about...
It's what the people want to hear, and we're not going to tell them no.
No, I mean, we're going to tell them no in a couple weeks, but we're going to give them something else. So we'll get there when we get there.
Yeah. And, you know, we talked about reaching out to Young Peg last week. We mentioned on our Instagram that the carpet is open for us to talk to him, and he commented with a thumbs up and liked the post, so... It's just a matter of time before Dave and I put the wheels in motion to try and make that happen.
He's going to be the third Lord of Grantham.
We'll see. We'll see. We got to talk to him first. It's all been winks and nods thus far.
I will say I followed him on my personal account. He followed me back, and he's been looking at my stories.
So he's been winking and nodding at you?
I don't know if he's been winking at my stories. Really, aren't pictures of me all that often, but.
Okay.
The man's been seeing my like Spotify screen caps and stuff like that. So here's what I'll say to our Lords of Grantham loyal listeners. Mm-hmm. Go follow John C. Elmore on Instagram. Just do it. He'll follow you back, and you don't even need to say we sent you. Here's what I'm gonna do right now. Mm-hmm. Where John C. Elmore? I'm gonna screen cap his follower number right now. Now I know we're not the most prolific podcast in the world. But this man has 333 followers, which is pathetic because he's Young Peg. He should have way more than that.
Don't say it's pathetic. It's, you know, he's living his life.
It's unfortunate considering he's Young Peg. Mm-hmm. We owe Young Peg, as well as John C. the Man, the Lords of Grantham rub. So go on, if you're listening to this and you're on the gram, and follow John C. He's got a lot of pictures of his kids. He's got a lot of pictures of his friends, his vintage pictures of his family. He seems like he's a sweet guy. He's cool.
Yeah, he's out there. So we'll see. We'll see about connecting. But
all you fans, then, do your part.
Yeah, I don't think there's much else going on in the world of Downton. Really, it's a little low key at the moment.
Yeah, we're in the calm before the production photos and the trailer and plot leaks and stuff like that. So. What better time to be revisiting it than before this all starts? It'll give us something Downton segments when we're covering other shows.
The storm is coming, and we better get home quick.
Yep.
And that home this week is Season 5, Episode 5. Now, Dave, you asked me what episodes should we do this week, and you said we hadn't watched any in Season 1 or Season 5 this round. Mm-hmm. And I just kind of briefly looked over things, and... all I saw was that this episode had Brickers in it, and I was like, all right, let's give it a go. I'm not sure which Brickers episode it is, but we got to see what's going on with that, man. Because the thing I'm finding with us revisiting Downton Abbey is just the carousel of people who come in out of their lives, and they're mm-hmm. all memorable. Like, every single one of these people that we're seeing again, it's like, oh, yeah, that guy.
Oh, yeah, Lang.
Right, exactly. How could we forget you? So
this episode is full of them.
Absolutely. It's very much a standard middle of the season episode where it just kind of moves plots along, but a lot of moments in them.
I mean, there's one of the greatest moments in Downton is in this episode.
Oh, absolutely. And it does conclude one story thread.
Two? Yeah.
Okay. Well, let's get into it. Where do we want to start?
All right. Let's look. You want to talk about Atticus?
Yeah, you know, it's raining.
The storm's coming.
Uh-huh, and you gotta get home
quick. And
there's
thunder.
Yeah, so Rose is leaving where she helps the Russians, you know, she does some...
She's leaving like a bakery with a bunch of food.
That's what she's leaving. And she runs into a gentleman.
A Jewish banker.
Cinderby is his last name. And I said this last time...
No, it's Aldrich. It's Atticus Aldrich.
Right, Atticus. I said this last time we watched the episode, and it stands out even more this time. What poor writing for this meet-cute. It's just like this guy just happens to be there when she is exiting the shop, and it's raining. And it's like, what are the odds of that happening? It just seems like so just, I don't know, lazy is the way to put it. And there you have it. There you have a future Downton couple, ladies and gentlemen. It's Cinderby, Atticus Cinderby, and Rose. So
Atticus Aldridge.
Yeah. And that's, I mean, she takes him to work to meet the Russians, and they don't seem too pleased about him, given his religious background.
Yeah, well, he's part of the Jewish, like, what would you, exodus of Russia?
I guess you could say that. And Kerrigan is there, and he's like, sorry for my friend who doesn't like your kind. I'll go take care of him. And that's pretty much it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, because Rose doesn't even invite him to the party later. He's just like, well, that happened. I guess we should take note
of
this guy.
Yeah, because he's moving back to London, so...
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of like what happened with Michael Gregson and Edith in the... Is it Michael... Not Michael... Who's the one she winds up marrying? What's it?
Birdie?
It's not Michael Gregson.
The one who
Birdie.
Comes back.
Yes, it's like,
yeah,
Birdie with the newspaper. Sorry, they're also
blendable. It sounds like Julian has a way of, you know, making these people get together, you know?
He's a mastermind in the writer's
yeah,
room.
I don't know how
There's no writer's room. It's just him in a big table alone.
Yeah. How does he
laughing
do
laughing to himself.
Yeah. He has a big whiteboard with arrows connecting one character to another.
Mm-hmm.
So that happens. Let's just...
I feel like... I don't think it's that contrived, considering that it doesn't end... The episode doesn't end with them, like, married, you know?
No. But, I mean, in terms of ways of meeting people, it's just like... That guy literally has to be standing right there waiting for someone to exit to be like, oh, you need help there. It's like, how would you notice in the pouring rain? Because it's really pouring that, like...
But it's a doorway.
He's literally coming around a corner.
All right. Well, call Julian. Maybe John C. can give us a little insight on what it's like.
We'll see. We'll see. Other small stuff going on. Mosley is asking Baxter to know the truth about her secret.
Oh yeah, this is a random subplot to get dropped in on. So Cora already knows, and Cora says Baxter's good by her.
Yeah, and so she tells him the truth, and he's like, "Well, you're innocent, based on what you just told me. You know, you're all good. You don't have to worry about anything. Why'd you spend a season and a half keeping this to yourself and letting Barrow lord over you?" And you know, she looks at the camera and she's like, I don't know. I don't know.
Because Julian he had nothing for me that week.
Well, then Julian walks on camera and then he formally apologizes for that storyline. He's like, I don't know. I was just trying in season four, guys. Don't hold it against me. And then he walks off camera.
Did you see what I did with the guy walking to see Lady Rose at the door? That was pretty good.
I'm getting better. Thanks, Julian. So, yeah.
Are there commentary tracks with Julian?
I don't believe so. I mean, your mom has the DVD sets, correct?
I don't know if she still does.
What would she have done with them?
I don't know. What everybody does with their physical media. You get rid of it, you donate it to Goodwill or something like that.
Well,
I should see if the movie has a commentary track. That's a must for us before number two.
I don't believe it does.
I got the double disc. Maybe it'll be on the double disc.
I don't believe it does.
All right. Hey, I'll check when we're done recording.
Julian, it's top dollar to get that man on the line.
Speaking of top dollar,
mm-hmm.
I don't know, I'm trying to use that as a, speaking of top dollar, Lady Isabel might be a top dollar member of society.
Maybe. Also, I just checked. It's a commentary from the director, but not Julian.
Oh, okay.
So, calm down.
Well, speaking of top dollar,
mm-hmm.
Isabel might be moving on up, but the Dowager does not want to own up to it.
She's a little bit jealous.
Yeah, she's... And this is a real smack dab in the middle episode where it is just a... Even within the episode, this isn't resolved.
Mm-hmm.
Because the Dowager recruits Dr. Clarkson. I mean, this is a really who's who of Lords of Grantham favorites in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
Dr. Clarkson comes in, and she just wants Dr. Clarkson to suss out whether or not Lord Merton is the real deal.
Mm-hmm.
And
it's funny that she goes to Clarkson for this, as if he's the guy
because,
who knows
well,
best.
I mean, she's definitely meddling, because she knows that Clarkson has got the hots for Isabel, still. Mm-hmm. And Clarkson basically just, after some conversations about the hospital, Clarkson, or Merton is, like, on the level. And that's what Clarkson has determined.
Yeah, I mean, Clarkson gets to meet him. He comes over with the Dowager there. They go to his house. And it's like, yeah, this guy's A-OK by me. And then even the Dowager has to concede she's afraid that she agrees. Maybe they'll be okay.
Maybe Isabel will be moving on up in society.
I just don't understand, and this is just my own bias. Why doesn't anyone ever comment that Merton perpetually looks like he's petrified? Like, he looks like he just witnessed something that horrified him and left his face that way. He just looks perpetually just, like, stunned or just in shock. And I don't know. That's just a weird look on his face.
I mean...
Anyone else see
he's
that?
He's just thrilled to be around Isabel.
That's your look when you're around someone you like? You just, huh?
Yeah, I've been wearing a mask for the past year and a half, so you know, now it's a lot easier to hide.
Yeah, now you pull the mask off, and it's just this perma-grin, and your eyes remain wide open.
That's it.
Yeah. Anyways.
It did remind me that I like Lord Merton, that I think in the big picture of the show as a whole, he kind of gets the wrong end of the stick. But I think he's a good character, and I think he does a lot in his little run.
Yeah, I never fell for the dude, but I respect those who like him. I mean, he's a nice enough guy. Clarkson approves, he must be okay. What can I say?
Yeah, and Clarkson's not going to approve easily, because that's his crush.
Right. Well, I think he's kind of moved on at this point, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'd hope so, at least.
Speaking of moving on,
mm-hmm.
Someone's moving out of Yorkshire.
Well, who's that? Oh, it's the bunt, right?
Yeah. She's up at bat, and she's going to bunt.
Yeah, so this is concluding a storyline here that thankfully we've managed to skip over all these episodes that we watched. Branson says his, you know, that my vision for this country is different than yours, Bunting or whatever. He's just kind of like, I'm just going to, you know, stay put.
He says only a Sith deals in absolutes.
Mm-hmm.
Well, she says, you must loathe the family. And he says, no, I don't. She says, but you're a socialist. He's like, I know.
And we do get a healthy reminder from Robert early on, like, don't screw this up. You know, you've worked so hard to get here to be approved by all of us. Don't mess this up, Branson. We like you now.
He's like, look, I lost my fun daughter.
Mm-hmm.
I lost my fun son-in-law.
Yeah,
I don't want to lose you. I just can't. I'm getting used to you. It's just mm-hmm. It's just me and Isis in here these days.
Yeah. So.
But there's also the scene. This is another. I think these random rewatches have made me realize how much I dislike Daisy.
Because
Daisy is so bad in this episode.
Oh, I love it. I love because we talked about this last time. It's just, you know, Branson's walking through the house, and then a door that we know is there, but it comes out of nowhere, just opens, and then it's Daisy like, hey there, Mr. Branson.
Come over here. She's a Muppet.
She looks like one. She just looks like, I mean, as much as we joke about how old is Daisy, she very much looks like a child in this scene.
and it makes sense, because she's talking about her teacher.
Yeah.
She's like, my teacher has a crush on you. Can you go please talk to my teacher?
And she's like, you got to tell her you love her. or whatever, however she speaks. And
Brampton's like, settle down now. That'll do.
That's not how love works, Daisy. That'll do, Daisy. Yeah, because I forgot that Bunting was formative and Daisy wanting to learn and know more. And, you know, before Mosley took her on as a student, she was learning from Bunting and becoming radicalized. And as she tells Branson, we're the future,
you belong with us.
Yeah, let's keep moving forward. And Branson's like, man, I'm doing pretty good here. They treat me well. I'm eating well.
He's like, look, you're my underling. If I asked you to sweep my floor, you'd have to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So get out of here. And then is it Carson catches her? And Carson's like,
Yeah, he comes in with like a cane and just yoinks her back, you know, from behind the door.
She falls down the stair. That's the last we see of Daisy.
Yeah. But I do like what Carson's just like, wait, what's going on here? And Branson's like, well, oh, yeah, you know, we just bumped into each other. Why was Daisy there? Who knows? You know, Carson lets it pass. But, yeah, Branson goes...
The good thing is Branson's not going to be a narc, but...
No. He's too good.
Yeah, so he does go see Bunting as she's packing her car. Another... You want to talk about good timing in Julian's writing. This is the best timing.
Yeah. I mean, she...
If he went to the bathroom, he would have missed her.
Absolutely. So it's...
That would be... Can we... I would love that scene where Branson shows up in the car, is like pulling away, and he's like, but I feel so refreshed.
I had to hit the bathroom before I went and did this. I just couldn't help it.
Mosley had to wipe me.
So he gets her fresh and clean, and you know, he gets to send her off and tell her, like, you know, it's a shame it didn't work out, but I'm who I am now. And she tells him, well, I wish you had met me before then, but it is what it is. Let's kiss.
He says, I'm rich.
He says
I'm
that?
I'm rich.
Oh, yeah.
He just pulls a wad of cash out and he goes, this is mine.
I can't say no to that. And yeah, he's rich. And he clicks his heels and he says goodbye.
He gives her a little smooch.
Oh, it's a good kiss, I'd say. You know,
Branson's has the most luck out of any character on this show, aside from Lady Mary.
I mean,
Lady Mary,
aside from his wife dying, I would say, yes, he's very lucky. He's really swung upwards.
Yeah, I mean, Edith has a good roster under her belt, but a lot of them are dead or, like,
aging.
Poor people.
Yeah. Branson gets just right.
Yeah, Edith really only has, like, one good one. Two, I guess Michael Gregson's good.
Oh, absolutely, Michael Gregson's good. I mean, yeah, it's Gregson, it's Drake.
Gregson, then Birdie.
Birdie.
Drake.
And old Anthony man. Eden. That we can't, yeah, Anthony Eden.
Not Anthony Eden, that's the Prime Minister from the Crown.
And P. Drake, or P. Gordon.
Oh, what is his name?
No, it's Sir Anthony.
Sir Anthony Strollin, not Anthony
Eden. Yeah.
Yes.
Let's not speak of him ever again. Yeah, I'd say she's 2 out of 5. She's batting 200. Branson, though, meanwhile, he's got Bunting, who's annoying, but she's a looker.
Good looking.
Yeah.
Braithwaite, Sybil, same thing.
Great. Braithwaite, same thing. The woman.
And in the movie.
Yeah. So he's actually been batting 1,000, I'd say, Branson.
He's 4 for 4. And I think Mary might be Pamuk.
Mm hmm.
Matthew.
Mm hmm.
Tony Gillingham.
Yep. And then.
Does Charles Blake give him a smooch?
He doesn't get the full smooch. No.
And then.
They only get the hog.
And then Matthew Good.
Yeah, Matthew Good. So.
That's 4 for 4.
Almost. Yeah.
Half
credit to Charles, because I don't think he gets the deed done.
No, but that's Matthew, Kamal, Tony Gilliam,
mm-hmm.
and Matthew Good, Henry Talbot.
You're not counting Charles?
No, I'm not counting Charles.
You have to count him. He's almost there. So.
So then that's 4.5.
Right, and that's what I'm saying. She's like batting.
So, but no, you know what? Evelyn Napier pings cancels out.
If people like this conversation, yeah, I know. If people like this conversation. Wait, Richard Carlisle, we're forgetting him.
she's
that lowers her battery rating a little bit, because she
no it doesn't it does not
well she doesn't get the deal it doesn't close the deal with them, so
she doesn't close the deal with them.
Charles,
oh, I guess she does close the deal with everybody else. She doesn't, right. I don't think she even kisses Charles.
No, exactly. So if you like us conversing over who has the best dating history on Downton Abbey, let us know and we'll do more of this.
Lady Rose does pretty good for herself too.
Yeah. Yeah, she absolutely does. But Bunting sees her way out, I think, just in time for the show. She's a drag every time she's around.
She definitely overstays her welcome.
Yeah. So, good thing she's gone by this point.
I feel like anyone that touches an Daisy plot, aside from the old guy, whatever his name is, Alfred,
Mr.
not
Mason.
Alfred, Mr. Mason, yeah, his father, that guy, is brought down. Patmore has a real struggle to stay afloat in a lot of these Daisy stories.
Yeah.
But thankfully, in this episode, Patmore has a good plot, I would say. Kind of good, bittersweet.
She's received an inheritance.
Yeah. She doesn't know what to do with it, so she goes to a man.
This is the thing that confuses me. I mean, is there a scene where she asks Carson for his advice? Or is it so much as Carson approaches her with his advice?
No, it's the first scene where she comes in and it's Hughes and Carson
in the
room.
That's right.
And she's like, I need to ask for advice. And Hughes is like, I'll leave. And she's like, no, you can stay. It's just about it's a money thing. And then later in the episode, she's like, why did I ask Carson? Oh, it's because he's a man.
Right, or he just happened to be in the room at the time.
So he says invest in building.
I love that we get a scene between Carson and Robert where Robert is just talking about the fortune that can be made on buildings and stuff, and that scene only exists so Carson can have the bright idea to share that news with Patmore. I want to see more musings from Robert to Carson where he's just talking about things in the world.
Carson's got to be like 10 years older than Robert, right?
Absolutely.
In the movie, it definitely makes that clear. He's Carson's, what, early 60s, and I would say Robert's, what, late 40s? Early 50s?
Yeah, I think that's fair. Yeah.
Yeah, and but Carson's like, oh, yes, yes, wonderful idea, Robert. Robert. What if we called him Robert? Hey, Robert.
Rob. Robbie, my boy. But, yeah, he tells her about this building thing to invest in, and Patmore's just like, I don't know.
She's like, that doesn't sound like my speed.
No. Apparently there's a nudist colony in Essex. Maybe that's the place where I should invest in.
Oh, yeah. Well, Dowager's like, what is that?
What a way to kick off the episode.
It's so weird.
I don't know. It has
Julian must have seen a headline on, like, Huffington Post or something that morning that's like, nudist colony. He's like, yeah, it's wonderful.
Or he just gets his kicks just thinking about that. Like, oh, yeah, that exists there.
You gotta, what? He might be at the nudist colony typing that.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's not out of the realm of possibility there.
But back to Patmore. Mm-hmm. She winds up looking into a house that she can rent and then eventually, like, sublet. There's a couple bedrooms.
Yeah. It's a fixer-upper. She could turn into more. And, you know, there's a bit of consternation over how do we spin this to make Carson feel like he was included in this decision-making. And they say, well, his idea about buildings led her to this one. And Carson's just like, wow.
He's not thrilled.
No, he's okay with it. He's pleased, though. He's like, you know.
I think he's a little annoyed that she didn't take his advice.
Well, no. He comes around and says, you know, he calls it a small help. You know, his advice is a man of the world, you know. He feels, I think, respected. I think they save they save face there.
But there is the good scene where Hughes and Carson are walking around and he's like, do you think we're really out of touch, Mrs. Hughes? And she's like, yeah, I do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's pretty much that.
Yeah, and what other lob balls are there? Here?
Well, Barrow is serving some stuff in the evening, and the Dowager comments like, "You look kind of ill, Barrow."
Yeah, and there's also a couple. All he's doing is just saying mean one-liners.
Yeah,
he's like the Dowager without any sense of fun.
Yeah, like, he's just kind of moping around.
He comments
at this
about all the stuff going on with Bates and Anna. Mm-hmm. He keeps commenting to Baxter like, hey, you still owe me. You're lucky.
Yeah.
And it's like, get out of here, man.
Go do your diseased thing or whatever that you're doing
your
right
needles.
Now.
And go shoot up your saline.
Yeah, get out of the way. And yeah, he's pretty much just not looking 100% himself this episode.
Not at all. He's looking ghostly, and he's only going to get worse.
Well, we'll see if he can fix himself. Sergeant Willis has come to visit.
I bet you pop big for Willis.
Not enough Willis, as I hope, because they hype him up like, oh, Sergeant Willis needs to come and see us, and then we don't get enough Willis. I was hoping for more.
No, but I think Willis is the best part of the scenes that he's in.
Oh, I mean, of course. He's the best part of every scene he's in the show.
Yes,
and
they
I'm
have
not
to
exaggerating.
They have to question Anna regarding Mr. Green.
Mm-hmm.
And there's this inspector from Scotland Yard who's like asking all these hard-hitting questions, and he's like, were you in London on this day? And she's like, yeah, I was. That's common for a lady's maid to be in London.
Mm-hmm.
And the guy's like, I didn't know. Mrs. Hughes says it's common for a lady's maid to go to London. And this inspector's like, don't talk. And then Willis is like, hey, she's cool. And like every time something happens that's controversial, Willis is like, hey, let's calm down now.
Yeah.
Let's not get too far ahead of ourselves.
Just breathe a little bit. I don't know what sounds he makes. It's something, you know, I feel like I get that effect from when I see him.
Like a couple of years later, he's like, there might be an assassination attempt going on, but I'm just going to like err on the side of caution, take the day off.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, they pretty much just ask about where she was and what's going on, and they wrap it like that, and we get to see Bates talk to Anna. Wants to know what the inspector knew.
Bates has a very good line here, where he says, "No, nothing bad is going to happen to ever happen to you again."
I mean, he's not wrong, right? It's mostly upwards. Well, no, actually, I'm forgetting the big thing, right?
Yeah, didn't she go to jail?
Yeah. Immediately following this, yeah, it's all sideways from here on out for a little while.
Yeah, she still has. I mean, things start getting better for her.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, no, she's got to do some time to get there.
Yeah, so Bates is a liar, is what we're learning.
He's right.
And they overpromise, underdelivers.
Yeah. So, okay. We're also kind of airdropped in the middle of this episode into Mary getting dinner with Charles, and then Maybelline Fox.
Yeah, cause she's trying to get rid of Tony Gilliam. Bless you.
Thank you.
Trying to get rid of Tony Gilliam.
Yeah. And this is all part of a big plan. To get Gilliam out of there, because a couple episodes before this, he threatened Mary, saying he would never let her go, pretty much.
Yep.
And they kind of...
Never let her turn around, or they're back on each other.
Yep. And they incept Maybelline into thinking that, you know, she doesn't want Tony, but she really does.
Great scene.
Is it?
I love it.
I remember you loved it last time. And I think when we were watching this, I was like, where is this going? Is this leading to Charles getting back with her, with Mary? And you're like, no, this is all just part of a plot to get Tony and her together, and Maybelline together.
Uh-huh. I think this is a good one because it shows that, like, I think we all wanted, if the heist did not make us want Charles Blake, this episode makes you want Charles Blake and Mary, because he's just doing something out of the kindness of his heart.
He's suave. He's totally suave.
And he plays it so smooth. When Maybelline leaves... And Mary's like, well, what are we going to do? And he, like, slides over across and Mary's like, well, we're still here. We're still hanging out.
Yeah, and he's like,
all right, let's keep on going.
Where's the pork? Roasted, not raw. And then...
Oh, yeah, he's straight up. He's like, I want a medium rare.
Yeah.
We got to know his beef order.
Yeah, he's ready to eat. Good on that guy. Good on Charles. Underrated.
He's great. Charles on Ballers, great. Charles on Downton, great. Charles on The Crown.
Not as much, but Charles on the Downton Abbey Christmas soundtrack, amazing singer, beautiful voice.
Julian Avenden.
Yeah.
And he's in another show on Netflix that I heard is pretty good.
What's that show?
Bridgerton is what it's called.
He's on that? Charles?
Yeah.
Charles?
not Charles from Baller.
Oh, I got confused between all the Charles we're talking about.
Julian Avenden.
Okay.
All the Charleses and Julians.
Yeah. Well, Edith is... very much in the throes of her life in this episode with the drama going on.
And Rosamond shows up because she heard rumors about what Edith has been up to.
Mm-hmm. Right, because I think the Dowager caught wind of what was going on with the Drews in the last episode or so. So Rosamond is there, and she's consulting with Edith on what to do, because they go to visit the Drews, and the Drews aren't too pleased to see them there, as always.
Mm-hmm. To the point where, when they leave, we see Mrs. Drew saying, like, this is exactly what we said. She's going to want to tout her around to her family, and I don't want nothing to do with her anymore.
Yeah.
And who susses out what's going on?
Well, one moment, though. I do like that fight between Drews, where he's just like, can you just leave me alone? Just like, ah. And she's like, no, you brought this on the family. You're gonna
put that evil on me.
Yeah, we're gonna see this through, Mr. Drew. You can't just walk out of here. Tough situation for the Drews. But yeah, as you were saying, Dave.
The Dowager says, "What are you doing here?"
Mm-hmm.
What are you doing here, Rosamund?
What are you really up to?
And she susses that whole thing out. She says, I knew.
Yeah. And Edith is making plans. I mean, well, they start to make plans for them, Dowager and Rosamund. They team up to say, well, she can go to a school in France, and you can see her from time to time. We'll get her away from the Druze and living her own life. And this episode ends with Edith making a call to London.
Yeah.
And as we recall, that next episode follows up real quick on that storyline.
Mm-hmm.
She's about to take that baby and go far, far away.
Yeah.
But,
well, not far, far away to London.
Yeah, far enough.
She's going to London.
A couple hours. An hour or so. But, that's the end of that storyline. I mean, my main takeaway with this is, like, Edith really cleaned up since the last time we watched this episode. I don't know if that sounds out of line, but it's like...
This episode or the last episode we watched?
Since the last episode we watched. It's like...
Season 4,
she
yeah.
absolutely glowed up having a baby. And I think that's true, you know, for a lot of people out there. You just find yourself after, you know, going through life changes. So, good on Edith.
Incredible depression because her man is gone.
Yeah. You know, it's one of those things where it's like, I got nothing to do but just make myself look good. And, you know, that's all you have sometimes.
That's good, yeah.
Good,
hold
good
on to what
it.
You got.
Yeah, exactly. So, all right. Well, hopefully, you know, Edith is, you know, she not much resolution for the Druze. They're just kind of in disarray right now, but Edith is moving forward.
Yeah.
And I know we kind of just sped through this episode, but it's a lot of top-level, high-level stuff going on.
We've been doing this for half an hour. We haven't been speeding through it much.
Okay.
I think, are we at the main event, though?
I think so. There's not much else for us to cover, bro.
It's really not much of a main event.
It's an iconic moment. It's a throwdown.
Well, yeah, so we find out Bricker's coming back
yeah.
to take pictures of the Della Francesca
mm-hmm.
for a book.
And Robert's going to a party.
Like, what is with this dude coming back? And Cora's like, hey, this is going to increase the value of this piece. We're going to secure the bag when we sell it
mm-hmm.
because of Bricker. And he's like, all right, it's all good. I'm going out of town. And he sees Bricker and he's like, I'm leaving. You're coming in. Peace.
Take it easy. Take it easy, man. And they really cut to the chase. Like, Bricker is barely there, and we see him stalking through the night because we've seen enough episodes now to understand what this guy's motivations are, what he's up to.
Mm-hmm. He's looking for a Cora.
He's got designs. Yeah. So he gets to her room real quick, and she's like, you can't be in here. And he's like, I could be, and I am. And
she's like, I'm asking you to get out, please.
Mm-hmm.
But he's like, no. He goes, he acts.
Right. She tells him no a couple times, and he doesn't take to it. And it's not a good look for Bricker.
And I forgot how dramatic this is cut,
mm-hmm.
where we see him in there, and we see Robert come in like, yeah, the dinner was canceled, so I'm just decided to come home a little early. Hope that's okay.
Yeah.
In that bright red outfit. Like, he's coming
smoking.
In. And then he walks in and he's like, oh,
what's this man doing here? You know, they have a brief conversation where he's like, I think you should leave. And Bricker's like, oh, God, no, I don't want to leave. And the thing that Robert does here that is so iconic is he's like, I think you should get out of here. And he does a slow turn to kind of open the door. But as he's turning, he just swerves backwards and swats him across the
back fist.
Total backhand. To Bricker's face, which is totally appropriate.
And then he jumps on him, and he's ready to start throwing down.
Yeah. I love that he puts his whole arm into it.
And then he gets him on the ground. He's pinning him.
Yeah.
And Edith knocks on the door. It's like they couldn't have found another... couldn't have Daisy do this part.
Mm-mm.
Where it's like, is everything okay in there? And then Cora says, we're playing a stupid game, and I knocked over a lamp.
I love that Robert is like menacingly holding Bricker to the ground, and they're
you
quiet.
Killed him. How great would that have been if he even chokes him out? He died.
Yeah, they couldn't make a move.
And
but
they're like, "Oh
in the
no,
process,
what do we do?"
Yeah, accidentally killed him. It's funny though with that, those noise complaints. You wonder what else have Robert and Cora gotten up to that Edith has heard? Is that why she's so weird? Is she?
I was thinking she wouldn't have knocked on the door if she had heard it before.
Yeah, you just wonder if she's traumatized by hearing all that stuff at night.
Yeah, maybe.
Maybe that's why she is who she is.
But we also skip over the fact that like Bricker cut like lays into Robert.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, you don't treat her well,
right?
Says, you choose to ignore Cora, and he's like, eh.
I mean, Bricker isn't wrong.
I mean, he is. I think he kind of. They've reconciled. They've had their ups and downs over the years, Robert and Cora. But they're, you know, mm-hmm. they're married.
Yeah.
But then Robert says, "Uh-uh,
not gonna take it."
Thwap.
No, and that's great.
Yeah, iconic
television.
And then he's
like, "I'm going to sleep in my dressing room."
Which made me wonder, how big is his dressing room? What is the bed in there? What's the bed situation?
I think we see it.
We've seen the bed in there?
A queen bed, a king bed.
I thought it was just like a couch he's sleeping on.
No, this is a mansion. This is his mansion. You think he's going to sleep on a couch?
He's in such a mood. And we see the next day there's a party going on, and he's still kind of icy towards Cora.
Mm-hmm. Because, he believes her, but he's still like,
"You let that man in our house?
This is what you... You let him in with my room? Where I sleep with my woman? Who's you?"
Yeah.
Like, "Look, forget about Jane."
Mm-hmm. This is about right now.
Me and I have you. Double standards about men and women, and I'm mad.
He's heated. So that is on that storyline for the most part. Like, there's a whole bash going on at the end of the episode because I don't know why. There's just a party happening, really.
Yeah, they just talk about it. They're like, "We're hosting again."
Okay.
It's like, okay.
Sure. And that is the whole episode for the most part.
Yep.
Quick and easy. Good episode, Dave?
No. I hated it.
Oh, you sure?
I was miserable. I was legit like, you know how we, last time, I was like, I was waiting for the pigs to show up. And then I was like, oh, no, I'm fun. Like, Jack Ross is here. All this stuff is going on.
Mm-hmm.
Cousin Rose. There's Anna and Bates get to go on that date.
Yeah.
This episode, I was like, this is boring. I am nothing happens until Robert and Bricker goes down. I was and Atticus and Lady Rose.
Yeah, I was about to say, like, yeah, I know we reflect more positively on season 5 than season 4. This is very much, like I said at the top of this episode, a lot of plots moving for season 5 episode 5. I wouldn't say it's bad. It's just like a necessary movement episode. But
yeah, it's definitely a middle episode. I think we were attracted by
the brawl.
By Bricker, by Charles Maybelline Fox, by all these names that come in that are like interesting.
It's one of the,
it did nothing for me. I was not a fan.
All right. Well, I didn't hate it that much as you did.
I mean, I didn't hate it. It's Downton Abbey. It's
you said you hated it a few minutes ago.
Relative to good Downton Abbey. But it's, you know, like, boring episodes of The Crown were unbearable.
Right.
Boring episodes of Downton Abbey are
disappointing.
Like, it's just like it's like getting a Hershey bar instead of a Reese's peanut butter cup.
Like, no, it's like watching a wrestling pay-per-view where the card is stacked and then, like, everything is except for, like, one match.
That's true. That's a good way to put it.
Yeah.
Julian Fellows, big, big wrestling fan.
Absolutely. All right, so let's get to the power rankings. Who you got?
I feel like, all things considered, this is a very strange episode when you're doing the power rankings because so many things are left unresolved.
Right. So, who do you got, Dave?
Going down at number 3, I got Barrow.
Mm-hmm.
Because I feel like we're starting to see the effects of this cure that he's taking. And we see how he's sort of down to the level of just like snipping at people. Like, he has lost all of his gas from the O'Brien era. He's pathetic.
He's running on fumes, absolutely.
What about you? Who's going down?
I got the Dowager.
Mm-hmm.
She, you know, she's not going to be able to stop these two irresistible forces of Merton and Isabel, so yeah, she's
going to be... In fairness, she does suss out Edith. That's why she didn't go on my ranking. That's a noble effort.
She's going down a peg either way, though.
She already did lose a peg.
Absolutely. Who's number 2?
Chauncey. I got Maybelline Fox.
Really?
She gets brought in, and they play her like a fiddle. Charles plays her like a fiddle, and then turns her around and sends her off and says, you know, "This is all part of the plan."
Okay, well, if it leads to love, then it's all worth it. So, you know, who knows?
Not with Tony Gilliam. That guy's rotten. That guy's worse than worse than Richard Carlyle.
Yeah, he's not. He actually might be, yeah. Well, at number 2, I got Bricker. He gets clowned. Doesn't get his way.
That's true. to me, it's one scene. The Mabel and Flock scene is real good. The Bricker scene, he just gets punked.
Yeah. So that's your number one?
No, my number one's Edith.
Oh, really?
Because Mr. Drew's like, no more coming around. And then her support structure is like, hey, no more baby. We're sending her to France.
Mm-hmm.
Well, who's number one for you then?
Oh, it's the Drews. This is, you know, they're getting the child taken. The child is being taken away from them, and they are just miserable together.
Hadn't happened quite yet.
Okay. All right. Well, it's about to happen. And
if we could forecast it, yes, the Drews. I would say Mrs. Drew more than Mr. Drew, because Mrs. Drew is in the dark about all this stuff. Mr. Drew at least knows what's going on, and he's being manipulative and unintentionally.
Mr. Drew's going to be in the doghouse for quite some time. So,
oh, jeez.
Yeah.
You're telling me.
So,
Utree Farm is going up to the highest bidder.
Absolutely. Mr. Mason, we're taking calls.
Well, who's going up for you?
Well, number three, I got Rose. She met a man. There you go.
That's simple. Going up for me, I got Charles Blake.
Okay.
This is a great one scene. He sets a plan in motion and orders his beef medium rare.
There you have it.
Boom. It's great. He's my guy. I was so happy to see him this time. Actually, not be some sort of a nudge like he is in season 4, episode 6 when we saw him last time.
Yeah, he's on the ball.
Yeah.
Well, number two, I got Branson. And
okay, fair.
He makes a good, strong choice of just like, you know what, I'm moving on. I'm going to take one last smooch.
First one, too.
Does he take a first one, too?
I think that's his first kiss with her. I don't think he kisses her before.
Oh, that's what I mean. Okay, yeah, yeah. Well, he snogs her, and he wishes her well. He looks like a gentleman, and he knows his way, you know? So good for him.
Okay.
Ignoring that immediately following this episode, I think he starts to talk about leaving and stuff, right?
He's talking about leaving in this episode.
Yeah, so... Anyways.
Number two, I got Mike Tyson.
Okay.
Knockout kid, Robert.
Well, he's my number one, Robert. The guy gets a TKO. I mean, what can you say for the man? He's great. He didn't have to call an ISIS
help. Great scene.
Yeah.
The party ended early. He comes home.
I also feel like Robert's in a lot of this episode, not even doing anything. He's just around. He's talking to Carson about investments. He's talking to Branson, giving him advice about, you know, where he is with the family, not screwed up.
I guess we got
to
give him props for those scenes, too, because his influence weighs heavy on all the other stuff.
He is the influencer this week on town.
Oh, yeah. He can't be voted out.
No.
Well, my number one is Patmore. This is big, big, big money Patmore.
Okay. Yeah, she's
straight
got the money.
To the moon.
Yeah. She's rolling in the money.
She got, what, 300 pounds or something? Quid? I don't know. Forget exactly how much it is. But she's buying a house.
Yeah, she is the million-dollar lady.
I'll buy a house for $300.
I don't think I would. I don't think it would be a wise investment. I think it would be like a shanty.
Airbnb it?
The amount of money to fix it up would not make it worth it, I don't think. A $300 house? Am I buying like a child playset house?
It's like a tiny home. That's probably even too cheap for a tiny home.
Yeah. Well, just for reference, last time we watched the show, I had Blake at number three, Patmore at number two, Robert at number one.
So we had the same three, you just had them at different orders.
Last time. This time I had completely different three of them.
Wow. So, well, that I guess shows how this episode is.
Yeah. It's loaded. So that is that. Dave, have you been watching anything else, man?
Just The Sopranos.
Do you find you're turning into an Italian man?
Well, I mean, I am a quarter Italian, but I'm definitely taking... Yeah.
Okay.
So, but I'm definitely talking like Tony Soprano in my head.
But what does that sound like exactly?
I can't say. He's very profane.
Okay. All right. I'll leave it at that.
That show definitely hits all the Lords of Grantham buttons.
Yeah.
It's a lot of characters.
Mm-hmm.
Always different plots, all the other side characters. I think it's some weird, I don't know if I just said why I got into it, but it's like everything in my life was like two podcasts that I listened to that aren't connected were like, oh, we're re-watching The Sopranos. And then my brother's like, I'm watching The Sopranos. And then some friends of ours are like, oh, talking about The Sopranos. It's just like, I had to do it.
Yeah.
And the episodes are not like Game of Thrones. Like they're like 50 minutes.
I'll get to it someday. I've just never been much for Italian mob stories. It's just never been something that like tickles my fancy, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah,
you'll fall in love with them, the Italians, very quickly.
Okay, I believe you.
What about you? What are you watching? Any Korean dramas? Or
no,
or?
I've had a busy week, so I haven't really had much time to watch anything. I have actually. My brother got a login to Discovery Plus, so I've been going through some of the Man versus Food content on there.
Oh man, is it? It's what's the guy's name? Adam Richman.
Adam Richman. They've replaced him with another guy because he hasn't been on there for years.
Wait, because he didn't. He thought he was gonna die or something.
Right, right. They changed the concept to Nation versus Food or whatever because he needed other people.
So they just have strangers do it, right?
Right.
Some people do it.
But then they had another guy come on and be the one to take it on, and he actually does a better job than Adam Richman at making a dent in the food, but 90% of the time never finishes it. But
I remember there's one at Man vs. Food. I don't know if you saw it, where like if you do the challenge, you get a guitar.
Oh yeah, there's always a prop where like you know you get your name on the wall or some silly thing that they give you for completing it.
But they make it like, oh, you win this guitar. This is and it's like a $50
yeah
bottom barrel guitar.
Right, it's so cheap, but. It's so easy on Discovery Plus because you can literally just look through like where's the New Haven episodes. Just watch all New Haven episodes, knock them out. It's like
is Guy on there? Is that Food Network?
Yeah, Guy's on there and everything. So you can literally just look at the Diners and Drive-ins for all the stuff in Connecticut or wherever you want to look at, and it's like this is great because I only want to look at stuff in New York, so I can go visit.
Get Guy to go have Miss Patmore's food.
Sure, why not?
That'd be a fun crossover.
I mean, a guy seems like that kind of guy. If you go on his Twitter, it's just him trying to infiltrate every piece of media out there, you know, just putting his face
just
in
putting,
things. So.
Putting his goatee on Baby Yoda. And
yeah, it's so weird.
Putting a bottle of donkey sauce in Wanda and the Vision's hands.
Yeah.
Like, what are they up to, dude?
You can just see him riding up to Downton, you know, just like, what up?
Yeah, in like a 1920, like a Model T, like,
yeah.
Here I am at Downton. That would be great.
I totally watch that.
We need a Photoshop. If any of our fans are artistic, let's get some fan art of Guy Fieri rolling up to the.
Oh, and if we tweet it, there's a good chance Guy will see it and be like, take it and run with it. He'll put it on his Twitter.
We need to. The thing is, Guy's an opportunist, so we need to like post it and then wait for movie two and be like, Guy, check this out, and he'd be like, oh, sounds great.
That's how you do it. But yeah, Discovery Plus, it's a pretty good streaming option out there if you have access to it.
Yeah,
but yeah, that's this week, and you know where to find us on the Twitter, on the Instagram, Facebook. We got a website, we got merch, we got a Patreon, and
yep.
5-star rating and reviews if you so choose on iTunes.
Yeah, and don't only find us on Instagram.
Mm-hmm.
Find John C. Elmore.
Yeah, we're keeping tabs.
Follow him. We're bumping those numbers. Next week we'll do another count.
Yep.
On the John C. followers.
We'll let you know.
So all that fun stuff and. Be good. Stay healthy. Get your shot if you don't have one. All that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Take care.